Hey guys, we're down at the Timothy Vogler Smithy. Today we're here to talk about brass casting and metallic bonding. Our brass that we're casting is made up of 85% copper and 15% zinc. We're going to combine those two metals, ramp our temperature up to about 2,000 degrees, liquefying that brass, and cast it into form. Brass was very commonly used in the 18th and 19th century. You'll see it in cookware, you'll see it for things like candlesticks, and for Moravians, typically in their musical instruments. Metallic bonds differ from ionic or covalent bonds. As you see on the periodic table, metals comprise nearly 80% of known elements. You might know ionic bonds as bonds that take place between elements of metal and a nonmetal in a 1-to-1 ratio. A common example of ionic bonds is between sodium and chlorine. This forms sodium chloride, or commonly table salt. Sodium's 1 valence electron is attracted to chlorine's 7 valence electrons, forming a balanced outer valence of 8 electrons. Covalent bonds differ from ionic bonds as they occur between two nonmetals. A common example of a covalent bond is water. The oxygen atom contains 6 valent electrons and wants to balance its outer shell to 8, thereby attracting 2 hydrogen atoms carrying a full outer shell of 8 valence electrons. Metallic bonds are different in their relationship to ionic or covalent bonds. When metals bond between one another, they form an alloy of metals. In contrast to ionic or covalent bonds, metallic bonds delocalize and form a sea of electrons. This sea of electrons is formed around a positive nucleus of the metal. This free state of electrons contributes to the metals being excellent conductors. So instead of electrons orbiting their respective atom, they are delocalized and interact freely throughout the space between the atomic nuclei. So today we're going to look at our metallic bonds and the sea of electrons. In this case, we're forming an alloy of brass, which again is a combination of copper and zinc. We'll combine those two to form that alloy of brass that we'll use to cast. Now let's go back to the smithy and cast some brass. We're making a mold for a key, in this case, that we'll cast in brass. First, we need a pattern. So we've got our pattern board here and we've got our pattern. In this case, our pattern is made out of iron. Typically, we're making our pattern out of wood. We'll set that pattern piece into our pattern board, and you can see that sets halfway in place. Then we'll take our flask. The cope of our flask will be the top of our flask box. Once that's in place, I'll begin to pack sand. We'll pack sand as tight as we can around that pattern piece, making sure we get nice and tight. At that point, I'll flip that box entirely over. I'll take off our pattern board, leaving the pattern in place. Next thing we'll do, we'll set our drag on top of that. We'll pack that drag full of sand. Now that our flask is full on both sides, I'll flush off. Once that's packed in place, I'll carefully separate the two halves. Carefully pull out the pattern piece. It almost takes surgical precision to achieve that. Carefully put the two pieces back together. Dropped in. At this point, I clamp my flask in place. So now our mold is set. All we've got to do now is then take that mold, set it vertically, and we'll be casting right into the hole that we have there. I hope you learned a little bit about brass casting today and the metallic bonding that takes place in our alloy. Next time you pick up your keys, take a look at them. Most of your keys in the modern world today are made out of brass as well.